Well, good evening. I would like to begin by thanking David Messina and the Museum of Science and Industry for their gracious invitation to speak this evening. And I also thank all of the sponsors of Science Chicago, who, along with Chicago Mayor Richard Daley, saw the need to reinvigorate the culture of science and research in Chicago. And that's an interesting statement, given the great institutions that it exists here, the University of Chicago, Argonne National Laboratory not far away, the University of Illinois at Chicago, the Illinois Institute of Technology, and of course, as David has told you, my first job, the Fermi National Accelerator Laboratory. But the mayor saw the need to reinvigorate the culture of science and research here, to engage and inform the public, and very importantly, to inspire Chicago's 700,000 children. The Science Chicago mission to awaken the inner scientist, and that's a quote, in everyone is more pertinent now than ever as our nation and as our world confront today's myriad challenges, many of which sit at the intersection of science, technology, and public policy. Global pandemics, HIV/AIDS, natural disasters, climate change, and of course, global energy security. The world certainly has changed in many and dramatic ways during the past few months. While the shifts seem sudden, most were years in the making, and many are the product of the flattening and interlinking of our world, in which the fates and fortunes of nations and economies rise and fall as one. What began as a subprime mortgage lending crisis in the United States, with concomitant falling real estate prices, was exacerbated by over-leveraged, globally linked capital flows, complicated financial instruments, and sometimes less than transparent financial trading schemes. This created a credit collapse that has reverberated through the global economy. As growth has slowed, oil prices have fallen, as have prices for many commodities, because global demand has softened. The United States faces a new and more complex economic future, in which past assumptions are no longer valid, and proposed solutions for government, for financial institutions, for commerce and industry, and for people are evolving almost daily. Underlying economic weaknesses have brought us to the brink of a global recession. Indeed, last Friday, the European Union declared that the 15 countries that use the euro are officially in a recession, as their economies shrank for a second straight quarter because of the world financial crisis and contracting demand. Japan, the world's second largest economy, has declared that it is in a recession. China, the world growth leader, recently has announced its own economic stimulus package of 4 trillion yuan, nearly 600 billion US dollars, to keep its gross domestic product growth above 7% by investing in infrastructure and social services. Such news from around the world makes it evident, more evident than ever, that global economies are inextricably interlinked and interconnected. Indeed, that the world is flat, as Tom Friedman likes to say. Given this shifting mosaic of difficulties, some have wondered whether energy security and climate change mitigation should take a back seat to more pressing concerns. But the need for energy to fuel economies and to improve living standards has not gone away. The urgency of climate change is ever present. Indeed, the interlinked challenges of energy security and climate change are a global economic security issue, and for the US, a national security issue as well. But there are opportunities inherent within these challenges, opportunities that can lead us to new prosperity, bolster our competitiveness, enhance our global leadership, and strengthen the global community. To be sure, within the naturally symbiotic relationship of challenges to opportunities may lie, in fact, our best hope. Indeed, on Tuesday, Chicagoan President-elect Barack Obama indicated that he intends to move rapidly on climate change and new energy-saving technologies. He repeated his campaign promise to invest $150 billion in energy security research and made clear that such investments would create jobs, advance renewable energy sources, help reverse global warming, and strengthen our national security. This is welcome news. You may have read, in fact, about vast brown clouds that are sweeping from the Arabian Peninsula across India and parts of China to the Yellow Sea. The noxious clouds are a mix of automobile exhaust, coal-fired power plant emissions, chemical industry effluents, and particulate matter from slash-and-burn agriculture, and dung and wood cooking fires. The clouds, in fact, are blotting Asian skies, reducing sunlight, decreasing crop yields, altering weather patterns, and fouling the lungs of millions of people. These are critical problems. Climate change does not wait. Many have been preparing for a time when our nation would tackle these issues. I am one of them. Throughout my career, I have maintained an interest and involvement in energy issues, both the scientific and technological aspects, as well as federal and state policy. Today, I am involved in a number of national and global initiatives in these areas. They include the Brookings Institution Energy Security Roundtable and the Task Force on Energy and Climate Change of the Council on Foreign Relations. In fact, I've just returned from the World Economic Forum Summit on the global agenda in Dubai, where I was involved in helping to set the agenda for next January's World Economic Forum annual meeting in Davos, Switzerland. Energy security was high on the agenda. Now, I also am privileged to lead the Energy Security Innovation and Sustainability Initiative of the U.S. Council on Competitiveness, along with co-chairs Jim Owens, chairman and CEO of Caterpillar, and Mike Lankford, who is the national president of the Utility Workers Union of America, AFL-CIO. And I note that my good colleague, Bob Rosner, here in the audience, is as well on the steering committee of that initiative. Now, the council is a coalition of business, labor, and academic and research leaders focused on initiatives, policies, and actions which can grow our economy and help it to remain globally competitive, maintain our standard of living, and provide high-wage jobs for Americans. Now, I will review some of the recommendations the Council has prepared, especially for the first 100 days of the new administration. But first, to know where we are going, we must know where we are. So let us examine the global context. Uncertainty of energy supply, amplified demand, unpredictable price swings, and the impact of climate change have been major drivers of a global energy system restructuring. This restructuring continues, even in the present recessionary environment, and includes new forces, new players, and new alignments. Let me tell you about a couple of them. First, new energy markets are developing worldwide, providing opportunity and options for new players. Second, supplier countries and their national oil companies are changing the terms of reference for traditional energy behemoths, especially with regard to oil and gas supply. Third, oil-generated wealth and central banks in developing countries are changing who plays in global financial markets. Now, I also happen, among many things, to sit on the board of the New York Stock Exchange.